Okay, well, I guess we'll get started here and then everyone else can join us after. So hello and thank you for joining the third Forestry Adaptation Community of Practice webinar today. And for those of you who don't know me, my name is Annette Morand and I'm the facilitator of the online Climate Change Adaptation Community of Practice, which is actually run by OCR, which is the Ontario Centre for Climate Impacts and Adaptation Resources located in Sudbury, Ontario. So the agenda for today's webinar is as follows. I'm just going to give a short introduction followed by the main presentation, which will go for about 40 to 45 minutes. And then after which we will have about 10 to 15 minutes for a discussion. And please let us know if you're having any trouble viewing the slides today or if there's a delay, just because the Adobe was running kind of slow earlier. We just want to make sure everyone can see the slides. And just a quick reminder before we start, if you haven't done so already, would you kindly dial *6 to mute your phones, and as well as mute your computer speakers, just because we record the webinar and sometimes the program can pick up some feedback. And as well, I want to bring your attention to the chat function on the left-hand side of your screen. If you have any questions or concerns during the presentation, just simply click on this area to use the chat function to just send me a quick message if you need an immediate response. Or if you have any questions for the presenter, we just ask that you please hold them until the end when we have our discussion session. So for those of you who are maybe not familiar with the Community of Practice website, it's an interactive online community that brings together experts from across Canada who work on climate change adaptation. The COP is a private site. It currently holds over 400 members, including provincial and territorial employees, as well as individuals from other levels of government, academia, the nonprofit sector, and the private sector. And the site provides a platform that enables members to come together to share resources and discuss topics of interest. Thank you. It is also home to the Forestry Adaptation Community of Practice, or the FACoP, which is a subcommunity of the main COP site dedicated to those members working in the forestry field or who are simply just interested in forestry and climate change adaptation. And it's free to join. So if there's anyone on the line who is currently not a member of the site and would like to learn more, just please contact me at amorand@morarco.org for more information. Okay, with that being said, on the line today we have Dr. Frederik Doyon, who has generously donated his time to discuss assessing vulnerability to biophysical impacts of climate change in the Projet Le Bourdon Forest community in Laurentides, Quebec. And just so you know a little bit more about your presenter, Dr. Doyon is a professor at the University of Quebec in Ottawa in forest ecology, a scientific director at the Quebec Institute for Management of Hardwood Forests, and is a regular member of the Centre for Forest Research. Landscape ecology and conservation biology provide the theoretical framework of his research, addressing scientific questions using field experiments and simulation models. And many of the scientific achievements have been in applying process and empirical modeling for developing decision-making tools aimed at designing promising sustainable forest management strategies, either at the stand or the landscape level. His recent work focuses on the impacts of climate change on southern forests of Quebec and the vulnerability and adaptation of communities who depend on them. And his presentation today will outline the research on vulnerability and adaptation that Dr. Doyon and his team are conducting with the partners of the Projet Le Bourdon Forest community in southwestern Quebec. More specifically, they wanted to develop an analytical toolkit which combined the impacts and adaptation as well as vulnerability and adaptation approaches to better understand how climate change will affect forest-dependent communities. So with that introduction, I will now turn things over to Frederik.
Thank you, Ned. Mm-hmm. I'm pleased to be here as your Valentine scientific on this Valentine Day. I can see that lots of the people that are there, I know them, or personally. What I'm doing today, I'll be presenting, summarizing the kind of all the work that we have been conducting for the last 2 years and a half. And it follows the work that I've been doing in the past, which were much more related to the biophysical impact analysis, And with this project, we brought the vulnerability and adaptation approach or framework and made them combining for a specific territory, which is the Projet Le Bourdon. So mostly, me and Dominic, we are the ones conducting the biophysical impact, but Guy Chiasson and Fred Condo are looking more at the socioeconomic impact. Guy is looking at the governance, and Fred is looking at the economic structure of the partners. So I'll start right now. So the founding is Natural Resource Canada through the Circumboral Initiative of Global Change and Boreal Landscape. It's an international model forest network initiative. And it's also founded by the Quebec Ministry of Natural Resources by the FONBA. And for the first one, the International Model Forest Network, I just want to say that we're a team with this project with a model forest in Sweden, which is the Berglagen Model Forest with researchers out there too. But I won't talk much about that for the rest of my presentation. So we're for sure in partnership with Le Bourdon Forest Community, and we are also in very close link with the Consortium Uranus on climate change, which is providing the basic information on climate for this project. So climate change will be very important in Canada, in the northern hemisphere, and particularly at the transition biomes where there's different species that will be interacting for different niches. And the climate is a regulator of several socioeconomic activities for forest communities, making them very vulnerable to climate change. And there's a need for tools to assess such kind of potential impacts of climate change and to better understand what kind of the adaptive capacity of those communities to better identify their vulnerabilities and develop adaptation strategies. So our project objective were to develop a suite of innovative tools that combine the impact adaptation as well as vulnerability and adaptation approaches. So what we wanted to achieve with this is to develop some kind of awareness around climate change and vulnerability and adaptation issues to the model forest partners' value at risk, to develop a collaborative framework around climate change, vulnerability and adaptation, and help building adaptation capacity of the forest-dependent community, and for sure to develop also at the same time the tools for exploring possible future outcomes under climate change. And what we want to do is using those tools to test the robustness of adaptation strategy that will be developed with the partners. So we base our framework or approach of our project, and we view this project more as a couple human and nature systems, which is what we call the, with the abbreviation, it's what we call the CHAN. And a CHAN is some kind of an integrated scientific framework for studying the interface and reciprocal interaction that links human and natural subsystems of the planet. And it recognizes the feedback loops between those systems and inside their systems, the fact that there's non-linearity and threshold function response, a lot of surprise because there's chaotic dynamics, some kind of time lag and legacy effects. There's conditions and attitudes that bring resilience among, and also their understanding of the ontology in time, space, and the hierarchy there's among the different structures. So that way of viewing our systems has been the foundation for develop our project. So we have four phases. Phase one is the vulnerability phase, where we try through a formalized group participation to understand the vulnerability, to identify them and understand their mechanism. The phase two was to develop a suite of models that will help to understand what kind of impact that will be coming out of the climate change and try to assess the exposure to these potential impacts in order to derive risk functions. The third phase is to look at the adaptation capacity and adaptation measure that can be that can be identified with the partners and see how much of this can be applied and what would be the barrier of implementing them. And the last phase is once we package those adaptation measures into some kind of strategy, how can we test them and verify their robustness against the several climate scenarios. So the structure of this project is using this impact and adaptation top-down approach on one side, where we have the natural systems that are driving the function of the response, and we start with the biophysical data and dynamics. So we're basically using the forestry ecological inventory, the last century vegetation dynamics coming from the different studies of the area, and also the Quebec climate change atlas that's coming from the consortium Uranus, where they use regional models to bring like a fine scale response of the climate change with basic climate data. This allows us to bring some kind of modeling, and I'll be talking about two types of modeling that we have been using for this project. The first one at the top of this box is an empirical modeling, where we use latitude for climate substitution for a climate-driven succession model. And also, you see at the bottom of that big box a processual modeling using Landis 2. Those two models help in understanding how the climate change will have impacts on indirect effect on the resources and the disturbances, which will allow after that to get into the notion of exposure. So we have on the other side the vulnerability and adaptation approach, which is much more a bottom-up approach. We're using the Projet Le Bourdon partners, and what we want to do with them through different participatory activities is to better understanding their perceived vulnerability and what will be potential impact and what kind of adaptation practices they can be developing using their experience. Because what we want to bring into the digital systems is having the perception of vulnerability, understanding the mechanism of the vulnerability, be able to develop those adaptation strategies that will be brought into the decision systems. And for sure, all those two systems, the natural systems and human systems, interact all together in our approach in order to better understand the vulnerabilities in some kind of a feedback loop between those two systems. So where, who? Project Le Bourdon Forest Community. So we're in Quebec, about 240 kilometers north of Montreal. It's that red delineated zone right here. trying to use the pointer. It's close to Montorgueil city. It's a small town of 13,000 people. The territory is close to 1 million hectares. It's basically based on lumber and tourism activities, but also there's officers there. And there's also a First Nation Etikamek of Manwa. It's right here in the north of the territory. So just to give you some kind of number to understand what's going on out there, it's about a fifth of the jobs in 2003 that were coming from the forest sector, which means 1,934 jobs with a gross domestic product of 140 million. After that, we got into the forest crisis, and this forest crisis has brought a very big drop into the importance of that sector. There has been a loss of 1,500 beer jobs and a loss of 118 million of the gross domestic product. So the first crisis has hit that area very, very hard, and that's what has brought the idea of developing that community forest model for. So also it's characterized by a very abrupt biogeographical gradient. As you can see, it starts with the deciduous forest, move into the mixedwood forest and into the boreal mixedwood forest. The socioeconomic activities are highly structured by the forest resource and dynamics specific to each of these three biomes. And a change in the size and distribution of these three biomes will have a very major impact on communities. So we're seeing that there's two types of impact. There's direct impacts coming from the climate, and there's some indirect that the climate will change the importance of the disturbance, and which will affect the resource, or the climate will have effect directly on the resource. So to address those type of impact, there's different tools that have been used. For the direct effect, we use Quebec climate change atlas, but for these three other type of impact, we use empirical and processual models that I was showing in the previous slide. So what we want to do is to look at the exposure and understand how the adaptive capacity faced with the impact can identify the vulnerability in that simple graph. Okay, so I'll bring you through the different phases that I was talking about and the activity that was run to accomplish those phases. The first one was to develop some kind of a set of impact that can be presented to partners so they can get a better idea of what could be the future, the possible future for their area. So we used the Quebec Atlas, and that's mostly Dominique that did that job. So it's kind of use the original climate model to scale down the information and bring it very locally so they can have a very good understanding of what will be going on. So on that slide, you can see at the top, this is the current situation for the average for the last 30 years, up to 2,000 years. And we have after that the average of the difference, I think there's 71 simulation coming out of the scenario from the consortium around us, and we have the average at the lower 10th percentile and the 19th percentile. And this is very important for the people to understand the kind of envelope that we can be talking about and try first to handle that kind of an uncertainty in the decision making. Not only presenting the average, but also presenting the envelope is very important. So we did the same for the winter mean temperature, showing how close to what's going on around Montreal will be now in Mont-Laurier. And also looking at growing degree days, which is much more related to the type of vegetation that we can be able to grow. It's interesting to show them that it will be like what's going on in the lower Laurentides, close to just north of Montreal, depending on the type of scenario. Look at the annual precipitation, not much change. Summer precipitation, not much change. Whatever is the lower percentile or the upper percentile. But what has been well recognized as being important for them is the change in the snow precipitation, and particularly how it will link to the snowpack duration for the winter activities for the tourism and the outdoor business. We also use the empirical model, which is led to for climate transition, to present how vegetation will react to that kind of type of change. So this is the climate-driven succession model. This model is for this area where you have in yellow the sugar maple, yellow birch, green the balsam fir yellow birch, and the dark green balsam fir white birch forest. So a very sharp biogeographical gradient is less than 200 kilometers. We had the different studies that have been conducted in this area from south to the north, and we have 10 landscapes of around 100 square kilometers that have been studied using old aerial photographs. They are all in the same kind of soil and topography, and they have been ordered with the degree days climate, so we can develop latitude gradient effect on succession. And in fact, that's what first we tried to look at, and we found that the degree days had a strong effect on the succession of the different communities. So this allowed us to develop this model using the data from the photo interpretation of the tree period, beginning of the century, mid-century. We had the vegetation, the composition, the age of structure, and the cover density, disturbances by severity and types, and we follow how the different community, tolerant hardwood, intolerant hardwood, mixed with tolerant hardwood, mixed with intolerant hardwood, mixed with softwood and softwood, changed through time during the last century by doing geospatial overlaying and data mining. So we have two intervals, early 20th century and late 20th century. We developed a random forest predictive model where the forest type that we had in 2000 was a random forest function depending on the forest type that was in 1940. And this is the forest vegetation that we have right now. Degree days, this is the growth degree data that we have right now, and watch a little bit, because the next slide will be there is a slight shift, but there's a noticeable shift of having greater degree days. This is what will be happening in the future in 2055. And after that, the model was using disturbance history with different combination of partial cutting, subcutting, and partial natural, partial catastrophic natural, and succession. And depending on the different combination, this had to explain the succession. We had also water body influence that was used, slope position, surface deposit, soil moisture, aspect, and altitude. So this allows us to develop our climate-driven model, and this is the error matrix. So you can see on the DAB and all that, we have a pretty good model. We have 82% world classified on the training data set and close to 980 world classified on the validation data set, with some few types that are much less well classified. For the mixed tolerant hardwood, for example, it's 60%. It's often mixed with the tolerant hardwood and so on. Some are less good, like these four types, but overall it's a very good model for classifying them. So it allows us to project in the future in 2070 if we have different scenarios. I'll show you that later, the different scenarios. For here, for example, we have no harvest, and it shows that with no harvest, there will be 18% more of tolerant hardwood, 8% less of softwood, and 5% less of mixed wood with tolerant hardwood. So we are able, with these kind of models, to present the type of impact that will be happening with the forest resource. So once we get the impact, we can be able to present that to the partners and look at their vulnerability and identify what kind of impact will be important for them. So we run a one-day workshop to look at the potential impact and also the opportunities that climate change can have to them. So we have three sectoral groups: resources, services, environment, and heritage. So we had about 20-something people in this one-day workshop. And we identified 47 impacts and 17 opportunities. So the way that we did that, which allowed us after that to classify the impact by type, like for example here, the impact is road access rupture. The type is a direct effect of a climatic phenomenon, which is an increase in flash flooding. The mechanism is bridge culvert and road washout. The sector that have been touched by that kind of impact is the resource, service, environment, and heritage, the three ones. The value and activity is road networks maintenance, and the vulnerability is loss, increase of maintenance cost, loss of access, and harvest and active season, reduction of active season. So we have done that kind of reasoning, thinking for the 47 impact and opportunity, and being able to classify them this way to better understand the mechanism for the vulnerability. So I'll be going through some of them, and in fact most of them, and we'll be giving you the kind of information we got from that one-day workshop. So for the resource sector, we have the forestry planning, silviculture, and management. One was the reduction in the annual allowable cut, or the increase of uncertainty around the AEC. Non-compliance with sustainable yield level that has been defined in the AAC, an increase in the cost and the planning cost, and due to more frequent adjustments because of increase of disturbances, increase of cost return ratio for so-called investment, so the return will not be as good as expected in the future. Those were the impact that they had been identified. For the operation forest job, we have cessation of harvest operation because of fire risk, environment restriction, forest salvaging operation, more frequent change in the operational planning, increase in insect and disease protection costs, increase in road network maintenance costs, because mostly because winter road use will be limited. So for the forestry, but at the processing mill, they will salvage wood will look with lower grade and value, will increase milling cost, increase in wood quality, unstable wood procurement sources, change in the species distribution, and many of those processing mills are very specific to the type of trees that they're processing. For example, here in the picture, you can see that this is a yellow birch that is being processed for adapting through for veneer production. Increase in the cost-benefit ratio of the product. So those were the vulnerability for the processing mill transformation. Agriculture. Now we one that was very important is production inter-annual variability, which will make the income stability very difficult to manage on in the management of their budget, and also the variable seasonality during the operation period. Like right now, what's going on is the operation period is switching from 1 month to another every year. Very hard to manage the human resources, make them ready at the right time, the, making them the waiting, and the operation planning is very difficult. Increased cost of material infrastructure. A lot of the tubes can be broken by the fall of the trees, and if there's more disturbance by wind through, this will increase the cost. Road access limited during the operation season is very critical because a lot of them are using oil to boil the sap, so the delivery of oil is very important. For non-timber forest product, we have reduction of the production and the inter-annual variability of production for income stability. Again, variability in seasonality during the harvest period. And for trapping, we have habitat loss for fewer bearer animals. A lot of them are using softwood type of habitat, which is shown to be reduced in the future. Lots of snowmobile access during the winter season because of the snowpack duration reduction. Variability in capture success and road access. So for the service sector, we have recreational and outdoor. The first one was income reduction for winter activities, road access during operation season, and landscape aesthetics. And cessation of touristic activities because of security, like if there's an emergency because of a disturbance, they have to bring people out of the area where they're doing their activities. Now for the outfitting, game and fish population reduction, changing game and fish species, and cancellation of the effort in managing the population and the habitat for those traditional game and fish of the region. For example, a lot of the lake have been, they have been putting small crops in, but if the lakes are no more good habitat for the crops, they have lost all these investments of the population. Now I'm switching to the environment and heritage sector. First, we had aquatic environment quality. First one was invasion by exotic species and toxic algae, variation in peak flows and frequent flooding, bank erosion and sedimentation in pools. We have for the conservation and biodiversity, loss of representativeness of the protected area network, invasion of exotic species, invasion of sovereign species, inability to maintain the protected species, increased pressure from disturbing recreational activities. What they were saying is with the longer summer seasons, a lot of the activities during summer recreational activities are disturbing, and winter is often seen as a resting season for the nature, so they were thinking that there would be more pressure from a longer summer. Lots of wetlands and forest towns. There is also First Nation knowledge and its use for traditional usage. So a lot of the usefulness of the traditional knowledge. So I told you that the academic First Nation people that have been part of this process. And for example, last week they were also attending the workshop last week, and there was five of them participating to this. So it's very interesting to have their participation because they have a lot of tradition, traditional knowledge, and they're following, monitoring what's going on with climate change. And the phase shift in the seasonality of subsistence resources that they are using for their own lifestyle. Last one is the land use planning and emergency preparedness. So emergency problem caused by limited road access, decrease of the viability of the knowledge on the distribution of resource, their dynamics and development potentials, increased damage to the infrastructure by disturbance, increase of dam management costs, increased cost in emergency operation, increased risk of being attacked by bear. That was one that came out from one of the participants from the epidemic. It was saying that if there's like a raspberry bear production failure, the bear are more likely to come close to the village and attack the people in the village. Reduction in real estate value. So these are the different potential impacts that the partners had identified by their own sector. What we did after that, we run a web survey to understand how important each one's what they were. So we had a monkey survey on the web, and we had them to rank the importance of these potential impact by sector. So we had 14 respondents from the resources sector, 13 respondents from the services sector, and 8 respondents from the environment and heritage sectors. So they had to, for each of the impact, to classify if it was negligible or very critical on 1 to 10 from each of these impacts. And this has allowed us to rank those different potential impacts in order to important, and also to understand, to have a better understand also of the variability around those importance. If they all agree at the same level of the very big differences, even if the average is giving something in the middle, there might be a lot of different point of view in regards of the impact. So we just did that in the last 2 months. So we're still looking at these results and try to better understand how these the importance of these impacts are distributed. So once we have a better understanding of the potential impact, we have been able also to switch and to look at how good we were in presenting the climatic data with the information we got from the consortium around us. And we found out that a lot of the vulnerabilities are defined not by those direct variables, but by more composite variables that we had to work on. And that's the kind of work that Dominic has done lately, is to take the data from the atlas and make it more talking to the vulnerability by transferring that into like a proxy variable. For example, we have freeze thaw cycle, how it will change, and we have the dark line, which is presenting the average of the last 30 years, and the gray zone is 80% projection and below for 2055. So we see how the freeze thaw cycle is changing. So the cycles are changing, but also how the envelope will be changing through time. This is the same for the Canadian draft code. And the draft code, what's the probability of having a draft code over 200 and 300? That's the two zones that we have. So we get a better idea, and we can present what kind of envelope and variation there will be around those variables and what it means to them in regards of their own vulnerability. This is a dry spell, not much change. Cold spells, less cold spell in the future. And warm spell, there will be more chance of having longer warm spell in the future. So this talk a lot when we look at that gray zone for many of the vulnerabilities that they have identified. We ran last week our second workshop on adaptation practices, and we used the potential impact that we had identified in the first workshop to ask to develop adaptation practices in order to mitigate the impact that we're identifying in the first workshop. So the workshop was basically divided into two activities. The first one was to identify the adaptation practices by sector. Excuse me. And we did with that first bisectorial group. So the first steps were A, to validate the order of priority that we got from the web survey. And after that, for each of the prioritized potential impact, we asked them two questions. The first one is, how did they react in the past to those climatic events that have affected them in achieving their business activities in the past? So what is already in their toolbox, the kind of adaptation measure that they can use? And the second question is, how, if this climatic phenomenon will occur more frequently or will be more important in the future, how would you adapt to these new conditions? What would you make? What would you do? So these were the two questions that we asked them to answer in their group. So and the, for each of the different impact that they had already prioritized, they put the adaptation measure. So we come up with quite a lot of different measures. And at the end of the morning, we asked them to identify the most efficient adaptation measure that they would like to see implemented for this sector. If they had only five to be implemented, which one they will select altogether. And remember that in these sector, there are subsectors that are very different. For example, FACoP is looking for different things than the ones that are the trappers. So they have to come out some finding some commonality in developing those adaptation measures. And the second activity, we use the five adaptation measures that they have identified to evaluate that. And what we were looking for this second activity is to see what kind of barrier there will be in implementing those measures. So we have 10 criteria that we use for doing this discussion, and this discussion was made all together. So what we wanted to see if there would be any group or specific people that won't be agreeing with the other in regards of the implementation of these measures. So the first question that we ask is, how relevant is that measure? Do you think it will be very reduced the vulnerability to the specific potential impact? Is it acceptable to you, or do you think the implementation of this measure can hurt you in achieving your business activities? Do you think that the society as a whole will agree with the implementation of this measure? Do you think that the region has the financial means to implement this measure? Do you believe that the expertise exists in the region to implement this measure? Do you believe that we have enough knowledge of the systems to ensure the implementation of this measure or to understand how this measure will be good in mitigating the impact? The two next ones are regarding governance. The first one is the regulation. Do you think that the current regulation or the forthcoming ones, because Quebec will have a new law coming in 2013, that's why we have this question stated this way, being a hindrance to the implementation of this recommendation of the adaptation? The second governance question was related to decision making. Could the decision-making structure institution that would be involved in the implementation of this adaptation be an hindrance? Infrastructure, do we have the infrastructure necessary for the implementation of this measure? And the last one is the social network. Are the organizations involved in the implementation of the measure sufficiently well networked? So these were all the criteria that we use, and the people were exchanging and chatting around those different questions for each of the 15 adaptation measures that were selected through that workshop that we had last week. So what we're now trying to do is we want to get a better understanding of the vulnerability mechanism and the adaptation capacity. So in the coming weeks, we'll be doing interview with 20 of the people that have already accepted to answer our one-hour questionnaire. And basically, we'll try to better understand what kind of attitude has made them more prepared to be facing climate change and how they understand those impacts to be, how they are vulnerable to those impacts. So this will be coming next. we'll be developing the adaptation strategy, developing like a set of package of adaptation measure, and we want to test that then after that with the two models. I'll show you an example of that that we can do with the empirical climate-driven succession model. For example, we here are trying four forest management scenarios, and for the different forest management scenarios, we have different area of disturbed area in 30 years. We have the no harvest, business as usual, clear cutting only, and partial cutting only. And we have the amount of disturbance by partial, total harvesting, partial and total natural disturbance, and aging, which is just the succession. So, for example, this is the matrix of disturbances for no harvest, natural disturbance only. If we change business as usual, you can see that we start to have partial and total cutting. We have clear cutting only, which is only on this column that we have disturbances, and partial cutting only, where we have only the partial cutting. It's all made to be equal in terms of harvesting the amount of volume that will be coming out of the forest. So this scenario can be after that check through the model. And here is the answer from the comparison of this. We have, this is a principal component analysis, and we have the distribution of the different forest community. On this side of the left is Portland hardwood forest. We have young hardwood here and Portland hardwood here. And we have softwood on this side. So what we see here is, this is how we start with the actual forest, and the pie chart is showing the importance of the different forest communities. And I want you to check for the orange part of that pie chart, which is the current hardwood forest. So this is the actual forest. If we do no harvest and there's no climate change, this is how this will change. But if there's no climate change, the importance of the mixed torrent hardwood forest will decrease, and the torrent hardwood forest. If we do the business as usual, which is a mix of partial cutting and clear cutting, but there's no climate change, this is the way it will be. But if we add climate change, the composition will be shifted toward more torrent hardwood forest. If we do clear cut only, it will be much more of the young softwood, which is the light green one, for sure, because they're clear cut. And less of colored hardwood, but again, there's an effect shifting to the left with the climate change. And this is if we do only partial cutting forest, only partial cutting our harvesting with no climate change and with climate change. See how much of the hardwood forest will be becoming under partial cutting only. So we can explore different forest management strategy, present that to the people, the partners, and see which one will be the most valued by the partners. So this is the kind of map we can do if we show how the business as usual will be shaped in the future. But the other portion of the work, and this is what a lot of what the MICSIR has been working on for the last year, is to develop the Landis model, which is a process-based general versatile forest landscape modeling tool. It has the physical environment embedded into the ecoregion, and the climate is also some kind of a layer that's coming in the model. There's spatial landscape processes like seed dispersal, insect disease, harvesting, fire, wind through, but there are also non-spatial, more at the community level processes that brings succession through growth and mortality. So this model allows to assess the impact of different forest adaptation strategy. Here is how we have managed to prepare the different cover that needs to be input into the model. So it's a very high resolution model with 900,000 active cells. And we have we have 33 species that will be in there. So compared to the other model, which is more community level based, here we have more specific species response that can be assessed through this analysis. So the objective will be to evaluate the relative sensitivity of the forest to slow and fast process, like change in composition, but also the different disturbances being either natural and anthropogenic disturbances. And what we want to do with this is to test the efficiency and the robustness of the adaptation strategies. So once we get that, getting back to my figure, we will be able to look at those adaptation strategies, how good they are, and bring them back into a workshop that will be conducted probably in next fall or next winter, and try to understand how they react to the different response of the adaptation strategy, which, and if we need to incorporate other measure or to eliminate some of the measure that has been brought in those. So I'm summarizing here what has been the usefulness of participatory activity in this project. It has been very important for defining the problem. It helps in changing the research objectives to make them more clearly adapted to their own needs. And also, we have developed with that participatory approach, we have been able to bring the impact and adaptation and vulnerability and adaptation into the same project. Most of the importance of this inclusion of the participant is to elicitate the expert knowledge and the collective wisdom is coming from them. Those people are very, they understand their landscape, they understand how it works. They have been working with the landscape for so long, and often there's many generations of people of the same family working in the same kind of business, and this knowledge and wisdom has been transmitted through those generations. So there's a lot of information there to be collected and gathered. So it helps identify the potential impact, the opportunities, the vulnerability mechanism, help to identify the adaptation measure that will be the more suitable for the area. They understand the barrier to the adaptation. And also, as they have been facing the crisis, the forest crisis for the last 5 years, they already have developed some kind of a resilience attitude and already some kind of mechanism that facilitate their behavior to get into more resilient behavior. And they understand what will be the implementation conditions and how those conditions will be facilitating the implementation. Finally, having them with us, it guarantees the implementation of a strategy, either by having them more interested in participating in monitoring or asking for bringing climate change into the decision-making and planning process, so the mainstreaming of climate change. What has been the keys to success in this project? I think the most important is to start with a mature group where the agendas of each one are known and respected. They've been working for so long together through multiple use trade-off problems, so all the time that they have to be fighting, now they're more in problem-solving attitude than fighting against each other. And they know the basic glossary when they talk to each other. So that's a very, very important point to work with such kind of a group like the one at the Projet Le Bourdon. The other thing is to have politics and practice together at the table. So there's a regional level of politicians that have very important, they have an important grab over all the decisions that will be made over natural resources. And they are following our project very closely. They are interested in that. They want me to be presenting the project soon at their table. It's important for them. And the last one is need for a glue man. It's very critical. Someone who knows the people, their strengths and weakness. We have the director of the model forest, Raymond Barrette, has been a very champion in this. He helped in coordinating and facilitating those workshops and making the link with them. Finally, my lesson that I will leave to you is the glue man is essential, if not indispensable, for this kind of work. Stay in touch with the partners, keep the link warm, but watch out not to burn it. If you add them too much, they might get disinterested in working with you. It's important to recognize the polar strengths among the participants and partners and take benefits of their influence together. And you have to acknowledge that climate change is not a priority for those. It's over 10, it's only 3, if not less. Adaptation has not been explained to them in the past. It's not recognized as an approach. Nobody has talked to them about the adaptation and vulnerability approach. You have to start from scratch. And the last two is, when we work with these people, you have to understand that the picture talks to them a lot. You have to have very good visualization tools and make those pictures presenting projection for their local conditions that they can see themselves in the landscape in the future. It's very essential for their participation. So that's it for today.
Okay, great. Thanks so much, Frederik, for your presentation. The visuals are actually really good in the presentation too. Very well done. So we have a few minutes for discussion. So I'd like to open up the floor to anyone who has any questions or comments. I know a lot of you know each other, but you can just unmute your phone to ask your question, or you can type the question in the chat box, and then I can read it out loud for everyone to hear. So are there any questions?
Frederik.
Yeah.
What a way to start Valentine's Day. First with a French-ish voice, Quebecois voice, and then with your brilliant project, like Make My Day. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you.
A wonderful work, absolutely. I'm wondering, we didn't hear anything about those many opportunities that you identified.
No. In fact, what we did is, when we did last week our workshop on the adaptation measure, we asked them how those opportunities can become adaptation measure.
Mm-hmm.
So we're still in the process of analyzing those answers from them. But for example, a lot of them were saying, for the outdoor and tourism, okay, snowpack duration will be smaller, so the duration will be very short. So we'll put our effort toward the quads and,
exactly.
And switch to the quads. Our marketing will be much toward the quads.
Yeah.
The snow won't be as good as in the past, but this effect will be even worse in the south. So let's make our region the last islands of snow on Earth. So they were already thinking, and I've been amazed because when we prepared our workshop last year, we were trying to bring the notion of opportunity, and Dominic and me, we were just wondering what kind of opportunity we can bring. As an example, we have none. But once we did the workshop, they're businessmen. They know how to play. They know how to take advantage of a shift and a change. And that's why they're still in business. They have been done for years. So they were always coming up with solutions and ready for switching their business into the new opportunity.
Yeah, we had to add disc golf to our list of adaptation options here in BC because that's been one of the first things that the folks in Clearwater did after we went up and showed them that they wouldn't have snow paddling several years of the year, so their local ski club moved into using their landscape for disc golf. One other quick question, Frederik. How much did all this cost in terms of funding and in kind?
Okay, let me think. I have to add all that up.
You could just send it to the
company. Yeah, Dominic has his postdoc on grant and add 150,000 grant. So let's say 2,000. And this is not including the part that Guy Chiasson and Philippe Cardo are doing on the socio-economy analysis, which is another 50,000.
That's still not very much given the richness that you're creating. Well, in my humble view.
Somebody else than you. What are you talking? Thanks.
Okay, thanks, Cindy. Is there anybody else with any questions?
Frederik, it's Kelvin here.
Hi, Kelvin.
How are you doing?
Very good. Yourself?
Good. Good. Thanks for the presentation. Great work there. And if I recall, like, as you went through this process, you guys learned a lot yourself about how to do this. And I'm wondering if there's one or two things, if you were to start the project again, one or two things you learned along the way that you might do differently if you had to undertake something like this again.
I think what we were discussing lately in the end of Nick is the first workshop we didn't put enough effort in preparation for it, and we didn't define enough well what we wanted to achieve with that workshop. Contrary to the last workshop, where we put a lot of effort in defining the activities, what we wanted to get from the activities, and why it was important to proceed this way. It's balancing also understanding, I think balancing the way to interact with the partners. It's all those participatory activities that we're not trained at. I'm not a social scientist, and neither is Dominique. So a lot of it has been done on gut feeling. I think what would be good is to have some kind of a good booklet on how to manage those workshops and participatory activities, how to make the balance and the influence of the exchange among the partners. That's something that I think we did was great. I think we finally succeeded in doing the right way, but it was much more on intuition and, let's say, some kind of good effort to do it. But it was almost by chance.
Yeah,
it needs a lot more of development on those aspects, to, and particularly when you work with the First Nation people, for example, during the workshop we had last week, I asked a direct question to one of the First Nation guys, and he looked at me like, how can you do that? How can you ask me a question? Like, this is not, it doesn't seem that this the way they are working themselves among their own group. Like, they ask people to talk, and if they don't talk, you don't ask them to give an answer. So it was very funny. I could see in his face that I did something wrong. But I didn't know in the first place that this could be happening.
Yeah. Well, no good. Well, thank you for sharing that. Appreciate it.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Any last comments, questions, concerns before we...
I don't know, Dominic, you might have something to add? No?
Oh, maybe not.
Okay.
I'll give him a couple seconds, maybe he has to unmute his phone. No? Okay. All right, well... Thank you, everyone, for joining the FACoP webinar today. And obviously, a big thank you goes out to Dr. Doyon for his time and effort. So I'll be signing off at my end. So thank you again for attending. And you'll be receiving an email with the recording of the presentation, which will also be up on the community of practice, as well as a survey to fill out. So thank you, and have a great week.
Hello, everybody.
Thanks a lot again, Frederik.
Okay, bye.
Thank